Good afternoon, Georgetown. I'm here today with Ann Leader. She is the artist that we're featuring today. She has done this series of pots, and they are part of our Above Ground Time Capsule. So we're going to ask her some questions today. Most of you probably know Ann Leader, either from the school or from the old jail. So, how are you today, Ann?
Just want to make sure people know the old jail is the artist.
Oh, yes.
Consortium.
Yes.
It's non-functional. It's
right. Not a jail.
Right.
So today, I want to start with, how long have you been doing ceramics?
Well, I started ceramics first in college as a kind of an antidote to the heavy academic load I had. I needed to do something just a little bit different from thinking at the time. And I fell in love with it, but it took about a year and a half before I actually had a chance to take real classes, just the introductory class stage. And then I became an apprentice as a potter for several years, actually, and then I opened my own studio. For a number of years, I remember being in coupons. And then I went back to school to get a BFA, and then I kind of got sidetracked into art therapy. So for probably about 18, 20 years, I was an art therapist and a behavior specialist as a social service.
For a long time.
Yeah, that was a long time. And when I moved back to Kentucky, when I moved to Kentucky, I was really hoping for that. Which, fortunately at that time, there was an art center called Artworks, and it's part of the Arts Consortium. And for a number of years, I taught there and made my own pieces and had wonderful relationships with the other artists in the community. And I had working shows, and then began to adapt an old garage at my house into a home studio. But at that time, I actually was diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer. And that kind of put a huge break. First of all, it's very hard on your body, and I had no strength. All the treatments were really difficult. So coming out of that initial diagnosis and all the trauma and the fear that brought, the one thing that pulled me through was clay. I remember about 6 months after I was diagnosed, I got my hands on this clay, and just to squeeze it made me feel better. So two friends of mine dragged me off to Ohio for the weekend. I took clay with me. And that was began my step back into the play. So from then on, you know, I've had to work in shows. I don't have the production to make a living from it. So I get some grants sometimes, or I have small shows, and so that's what I've been doing really for the last about 9 years.
Okay, so I want to move now into, talk to us about why you chose to do this particular group of class for the library. This is part of our commissioned artworks. This is our last piece that has come in, and there's actually a public part of this, so we want to talk more about that.
Okay.
So what was your idea? What was your inspiration for doing that?
Well, when you came to me and you said, I want you to just think outside the box, because I was working very small. And although these aren't enormous, there's a big challenge.
Yes, they're bigger.
About as big as my film will take. So I wanted to do something that connected to the library. Libraries, for me, have been really important in my life. I grew up in Washington, D.C., and one of the wonderful features of my high school was that when you did your research paper junior year, if you had a topic that the school library couldn't have the right books for, the public libraries didn't have the right books, you could go to the Library of Congress, and that was amazing. You also got out of school,
yes,
but you know, you had to produce something, so you were just floating around doing nothing. You were actually at the library working, and it was a very exciting process. And I think that throughout the rest of my life, places I've lived, libraries have been very important. I lived in Seattle for 18 years, and we had the distinction of having the first library in action figure, Nancy Pearl, who started everybody in Seattle read the same book. It was also a library that was open to anyone, including people who were homeless. So it is just a place where everyone can learn, and that's always important. And over time, you know, I've found out more and more about libraries. I've read a lot of books that have libraries either as the major character or as the subject matter. And also the idea that librarians are not just the keepers of knowledge, but also the protectors of our privacy. In America, knowledge and privacy are a really important part of the republic and part of democracy. And librarians actually can't just give anybody your reading list. People can't just sneak into your life. They have to have a really good reason and warrant. And so many librarians have been very heroic and standing against incursions into privacy, which I really respect. But then I was thinking, I wanted to do something specifically specifically for this library,
yes,
and for the respect I have for it and the gem that it is in our community. And I was up in Cincinnati looking at a show of a Nagamani scroll for the Dead Sea Scroll. And one of the things that shocked me as a potter was that when they found the scrolls in the desert, they broke the pots to get to the scrolls because they thought the pots had no value. And that was really sad to me because, well, clearly they're not the scrolls. They, from a potter's point of view, they did. So I began to think about long and narrow horns. And I don't know where these little arms came from. They just seemed to just pop out. So I thought, well, I'm going to leave them just the way they are. Sometimes pots speak to you. But the thing about the Nagamani scrolls is here was knowledge that was buried in the desert and then it was found. Mm-hmm. And of course, this is above ground. This is found knowledge. I mean, this represents the library that we should have here. So that's kind of the kind of way that this developed.
Okay. So, in the part about us wanting to collect public participation, basically we want anybody who uses this library to come in and feel free to kind of get us either your favorite book, your favorite quote, or favorite library experience. And there will be a sealing ceremony that goes along with these pots. You want to pick up a top so they can see. After we collect everybody's information, we want to put it down in here, like our own sea scrolls, but, above ground again. But as a part of a installation that remains here in the library. Do you want to talk more about what your thought process was? And for you who are visiting the library, what you need to know is that there will be more information toward the back of the information desk, and you can read a little more, but just give us a little taste of what you would think.
So part of what I really, first of all, I think that some people just see pots as pots. But clay is being one of the most basic materials on our planet and a very early art form, too. And clay can be used in three ways, basic ways, either to make vessels, to create animal or human figures, or as a building material, which we're very familiar with in Kentucky.
Yes.
And so, but people often say, well, it's just a pot, it doesn't really have anything other than a functional value. And first of all, I don't agree. I think that, at least for me, all pots that I make have some kind of significance to me. And I discovered this, I kind of realized that early on. I had been I've been a studio potter and I made functional ware.
Yes.
And that is, I mean, the basic idea is to have something that you think is beautiful in your home.
Right.
Any of you have done the Kentucky Arts curriculum in the school, you'll know that that is functional art. It's one of the art. But there's also the expressive part of it, the symbolic part of it. And we know, for example, that in Egypt, where you have the Canopy jars, although they're made of stone, they're still vessels that are used as funerary structures. Actually, the word encapsule comes from a number of different roots. Capsa is actually from Latin, which means it's like a bookcase. So these were like bookcases that they would put their books in. So every time I look deeper, it's one of the ways, a part of my process, I'll try to think, what am I going to call these? I just can't call them vessels. So I started to think about kind of word association, looking words up, and that's part of the way I work too. I think people who work in art and who kind of draw randomly or make things somewhat randomly, just kind of scribbling, getting ideas together, you don't always know what you're after.
Right.
That it's kind of an unveiling process.
Oh,
absolutely. I don't always know why I'm going in the direction I'm going in. And so as I peeled off the layers and started exploring words that captured what I was trying to think of, that's what this came to me. Because you encapsulate the meaning of the library. So, encapsula. Capsa, as I said, is a root as a bookshelf.
Yes.
And also, because we're not quite honoring cyberspace here, the way I had originally intended, the word capsule, also relates to a seed of plant whose seeds burst and spread out into the air. And that's really exciting to me because, this was the end product of a lot of thinking and making things and maybe taking too long. Trying to find the right collection of things. So I just wanted something that really respected the library, honor the library, and most of all honor the community that this is part of.
Yes.
I want people to come and say, well, I don't care so much about the books, but I love the computers, or forget all that, I want to go in the 3D printer. Maybe somebody's just here to look up genealogy. Maybe they just come to the cafe to hang out with their friends. I mean, this is a community place, and that's very vital for a town the size of Georgetown, which is not a village,
right.
But it's not a big city. So you want spaces where people can congregate and feel, aren't just the mall. You
know, yes.
People can come and feel comfortable with themselves. And the other thing is the egalitarian part of it. Nobody, there's no passport when you come in. You don't have to show that you're rich or super smart or any of these things. You can come in whoever you are. There's no dress code other than basic decency.
Right.
And it's a place where people can be. It's no longer a quiet whisper space.
Right.
I see quiet study over there. It's a place that's lively and active.
Yes.
Children come here for art. There's music. There's an art gallery.
Yes.
And so this is really developing into a wonderful community space. So I just wanted to show my respect and joy in the community. So I hope y'all will come and write out whatever it is that you like. It doesn't matter how small. Somebody said, well, how about clean bathrooms? I go, that's fine.
That's great.
Me. That's super. Whatever you want.
Thank you so much, Ann. Of course, thank you for your art.
Thank you for giving
and
me
this
opportunity. I have to say, I had to stretch myself a little bit. I wasn't sure I was going to make it because these are bigger than I can manage now for the most part. So there was a few moments of tension as I put them into the kiln. I'm like, am I going to drop it?
But they all came out, and we're very happy about it.
Thank you.
So please come to the library. Do not be afraid to come and look. Read the back, and please put in your information. Bye, guys.